It is October 22nd, 2019. I would like to present an addition to the lecture by Otto Pohl. It is about the German psyche and the German fate. First, I want to play a part of his video.
Again, then the other way it works as well is that the Germans are expecting, there's rule by law and the way certain things should be done, and so they do to their detriment, often act within the legal structures, right? And the Russians are less likely to do that, and the Kazakhs not at all. And so as a result, kind of the Kazakhs, particularly in terms of maintaining their culture and particularly in terms of maintaining their traditional way of life, do much better. But one of the things that comes about in this memoirs is in order to just physically survive, they have to adopt a lot of these Russian and Kazakh ways. So things like if it's not a millstone or hot iron and nobody sees you, just take it, right? The widespread theft of food and other necessities in order to survive becomes something that they have to adopt from these people around them, which is something, of course, that they never would have done in the all-German villages in Ukraine before they were completely robbed of all their possessions.
How does Professor Pohl characterize the Germans? The Germans are expecting the rule by law. The way certain things should be done, or ways certain things should be done, they do to their own detriment, often act within a legal structure. As a result, the Kazakhs, particularly in terms of maintaining their culture and particularly in terms of maintaining their traditional way of life, do much better. I thought that was a very interesting take of Otto Pohl, which characterizes the Germans very well. Yeah, the lecture is called, or this part of the lecture is called Dominik Hollmann's 1961 Letter to Neues Leben. In his series, Otto talks about the fate of the Russian Germans. He reads letters of the Russian German author Dominik Hollmann. Hollmann wrote to the Supreme Soviet with the request that the Germans get back their autonomous territories and republics. And, of course, they didn't. The rest is history. Hollmann believed in justice because he knew it from his German culture. But there is no justice in history. The world is not ruled by Germany. Die Welt wird nicht am deutschen Wesen genesen. Früher, in the olden days, that was the saying. Yeah? Die Welt soll am deutschen Wesen genesen. And now this is in very negatively, but it's a sword with two edges, or I don't know, in English, ein zweischneidiges Schwert. I, as an Austrian, have the impression that Germans somehow standing in their own way. Their central and often praised virtues often seem to have done them more harm than good throughout history. Now I would like to present two texts which, in my opinion, fit very well to this passage of Otto Pohl's video. The first text is about the German psyche, the second about the German fate. First I will read the text in English, then I will read each text in German because my translation might be faulty. So the bilingual people, which are most of the listeners here, they can check for themselves if they don't have the texts. And I don't have them either. Maybe they are in the internet, but I personally took them down by handwriting. First author and first text by Alain de Benoist. The text has been created in 1985, or first published. Alain de Benoist, a very famous French philosopher. I personally think he's a left-wing guy, but it says here he's Nouvelle Droite, but never think never trust Wikipedia. They don't like you in general. Yeah. The name of the German version of the book was called Kulturrevolution von Rechts, and I think it's out of print. And it's just a little excerpt, and I did the translation mainly with the translating device DeepL, but of course I had to adjust and adapt a lot. So, cultural revolution from the right wing. I don't know if that's a good translation. Actually, the translation website suggested cultural revolution from the law. Because Recht also means law. So, I start. The majority of Germans say what they think, and that's why they believe what they are told. That's praiseworthy, even very praiseworthy, but it is also dangerous. The Germans believe what is written in the newspapers. They believe in what is written in Der Spiegel, just as they believed yesterday in what was written in Der Völkischer Beobachter. Propaganda has not disappeared at all. It has only become a little more refined. And the Germans devour it with the same good faith and the same frighteningly good conscience. The Germans of today are obedient to journalistic moralism. And it is from this that democracy, the rule of law, unfolds. They want that... They want that there is no enemy left so that they can share themselves the attitude that they would have to adopt towards him. That's a mistake. I start again. They want that there is no enemy left so that they can spare themselves the attitude they would have to adopt towards him. They believe that peace can be achieved in this way. This, of course, is an utopian notion. Politically, the enemy is the one whose actions and interests can conflict with your actions and interests. And in this sense, there is always an enemy. Ignoring or denying its existence, I mean that of the enemy, is only conducive to creating precisely those conditions that make it easier for this enemy to carry out the plans that arise from its interests. According to Julian Freund, in the end, the negation of the enemy is nothing other than the negation of peace. So, nun die deutsche Version Kulturrevolution von Rechts von Alain de Benoist. Die Mehrheit der Deutschen sagt, was sie denkt und deshalb glaubt sie auch, was man ihr sagt. Das ist lobenswert, sogar sehr lobenswert, aber es ist auch gefährlich. Die Deutschen glauben, was in den Zeitungen steht. Sie glauben an das, was im Spiegel steht. So wie sie gestern an das glaubten, was im Völkischen Beobachter stand. Dabei ist die Propaganda gar nicht verschwunden, sie hat sich nur etwas verfeinert. Und die Deutschen verschlingen sie mit dem gleichen guten Glauben, mit dem gleichen erschreckend guten Gewissen. Die Deutschen von heute hängen dem journalistischen Moralismus an und daraus entfaltet sich dann die Demokratie, die Gesetzesherrschaft. Sie möchten, dass es keinen Feind mehr gibt, damit sie sich die Haltung sparen können, die sie ihm gegenüber einnehmen müssten. Sie glauben, dass man auf diese Weise den Frieden erreichen kann. Das ist eine utopische Vorstellung. Politisch gesehen ist der Feind derjenige, dessen Handlungen und Interessen mit unseren Handlungen und Interessen in Konflikt geraten können. Und in diesem Sinne gibt es immer einen Feind. Seine Existenz zu ignorieren oder zu leugnen, ist nur dazu angetan, gerade jene Bedingungen zu schaffen, die es diesem Feind erleichtern, die seinen Interessen entspringenden Pläne zu verwirklichen. Nach Julian Freund ist letzten Endes die Verneinung des Feindes nichts anderes als die Verneinung des Friedens. Which leads us to the second text. It's more about the German Fate. It's from Rolf Peter Sieferle. Just pull up the Wikipedia page. Yeah, Rolf Peter Sieferle. I know him as a sociologist. I didn't know him actually since 2 years ago. But I actually do. I've read a book of his. Karl Marx zur Einführung, which is the introduction to Karl Marx. So he is a Marxist. He used to be a Marxist. His first monographie in 1977 was Die Revolution in der Theorie von Karl Marx. And he wrote also about the environment, der unterirdische Wald. So he also wrote about the Bevölkerungswachstum und Naturhaushalt. So he's an environmentalist. And he wrote about the German conservative revolution. Can I find it? Die konservative Revolution. 5 biografische Skizzen. That's actually similar to Alain de Benoist. Because here it says politically influenced by thinkers of the German conservative revolution. And I also think that the second text I will read for you now has been influenced by Benoist. Rolf-Peter Sieferle, became very famous. It says here, sein posthum 2017 veröffentlichtes Buch Finis Germania löste einen Skandal aus. Yeah. His postmortem published book Finis Germania caused a scandal. And I think the following excerpt is from this book. Rolf-Peter Sieferle, I think he committed suicide in 2016. He's a very interesting guy in the way that he started, I think, as a Marxist and ended anyhow as a nationalist. When you just see how his last books were called Das Migrationsproblem, über die Unvereinbarkeit von Sozialstaat und Masseneinwanderung. The Migration Problem, about the Unvereinbarkeit, I don't know in English, about the no-go of welfare state and mass immigration. Not very well prepared. Unvereinbarkeit, I should have checked what it means in English. No problem. I will read for you the second text. This text is very profound thoughts, and I'm not sure if the translation is really spot on. So, well, just make of it what you can. From the collective guilt of the Germans, which goes back to Auschwitz, follows also the call to permanent atonement. But in this secularized form of original sin, the element of grace and love is completely missing. The German, therefore, does not resemble a man whose guilt is not revised by the love of God, but is compensated for. Instead, the German resembles the devil, the fallen angel, whose guilt will never be forgiven and who will remain in darkness for all time. The German forms the negative foil before the goodness of God can stand out positively. In the German's negativity, all the defects of creation crowd together in such a way that God himself is relieved of the agonizing questions about the justifications of the evils in this world. The German, or at least the Nazi, is the secularized devil of an enlightened present. This mature and autonomous world needs him as the negative foil before which it can justify itself. So, very deep thinking, profound thinking. Just to complete the German version. Aus der Kollektivschuld der Deutschen, die auf Auschwitz zurückgeht, folgt ebenfalls der Aufruf zur permanenten Buße. Doch fehlt in dieser säkularisierten Form der Erbsünde das Element der Gnade und Liebe vollständig. Der Deutsche ähnelt daher nicht dem Menschen, dessen Schuld durch die Liebe Gottes zwar nicht revidiert, aber kompensiert wird, sondern dem Teufel, dem gestürzten Engel, dessen Schuld niemals vergeben und der für alle Zeiten in der Finsternis verharren wird. Er bildet die Negativfolie, vor welcher sich die Güte Gottes positiv abheben kann. In seiner Negativität drängen sämtliche Mengen der Schöpfung in einer Weise zusammen, dass Gott selbst von den quälenden Fragen nach der Rechtfertigung der Übel in der Welt entlastet wird. Der Deutsche oder zumindest der Nazi ist der säkularisierte Teufel einer aufgeklärten Gegenwart. Diese mündig und autonom gewordene Welt benötigt ihn als eben die Negativfolie, vor der sie sich selbst rechtfertigen kann. So, that's about all I want to present you today, which concludes my video and my sort of video answer in addition to Otto Pohl's video, Dominik Hollmanns Letter to Neues Leben. Bye-bye for now.